In this session, we're going to review some basic concepts and terminology which are important to understand in order to effectively use the Biowulf cluster. Let's start with what is a compute cluster. The basic component of a cluster is a computer, probably very similar to what you have on your desktop. We call these computers compute nodes. Each node has processors, memory, a disk drive, and a network adapter. And if we then connect a number of nodes to a network switch with perhaps some network accessible storage, we have a compute cluster. So here we have a cluster of 13 nodes. From a hardware perspective, this is all there is to a cluster. On the motherboard of each node, there are two sockets, shown here in white. Into each socket is plugged a processor, shown in purple. So each node has two processors. Years ago, the processor was the lowest level of hardware at which the instructions comprising a computer program could be executed. However, since the early to mid-2000s, transistor densities have increased to the point where the circuitry could be replicated on a single processor chip, so that now a processor could have multiple completely independent processing units. We call these units cores. In this schematic, we have processors with two cores per processor. So this would be a four-core node, and it could run up to four completely independent threads of execution. Now, each core consists of what are called functional units, which are responsible for things like fetching and storing instructions, or doing integer or floating point arithmetic. Recent generations of processors are able to share these functional units between two threads of execution. This technology is called hyperthreading. These multiple hardware contexts go under various names, but for our purposes, we will call them CPUs. So this node has two processors, four cores, and eight CPUs. So to summarize the important points in this slide, a compute node can have multiple cores, and each core can support two threads of execution by sharing its functional units. And this technology to do the sharing is called hyperthreading. This schematic demonstrates hyperthreading on a single core. The blocks in the y-axis represent time, and the blocks in the x-axis represent four functional units. The blue and green blocks represent two threads of execution occupying various functional units. So on the left-hand side, with hyperthreading disabled, we have the blue thread starting, executing, and finishing, and then the green thread starting, executing, and finishing. And note that not all functional units are being used at the same time. That allows them to be shared with hyperthreading enabled, the result of which is the total execution time for the two threads has been shortened. Now note that while the overall execution time has been reduced, the time for the blue thread to finish has actually increased. So while hyperthreading may increase throughput, it may do so at the expense of individual threads. And this is a consideration you'll have to take into account when deciding whether to take advantage of hyperthreading. We turn now from hardware concepts to software concepts and terminology. So here we have two compute nodes, each with some memory and four CPUs. On the left, we have two programs on disk being read into memory as two completely independent processes, each running in its own memory space, running on a single CPU, and executing its own set of instructions. These are single-threaded processes. On the right-hand side, is demonstrated a multi-threaded process. Here, a single program is read into memory as a single process, but this process is running two threads of execution on two CPUs. However, the important point here is that both threads have access to the same memory space. Understanding the distinction is important when deciding how much memory to allocate for single versus multi-threaded programs. And note finally that a program must be written to be multi-threaded. It doesn't happen automatically. This last slide summarizes the concepts in this video. Starting from the top, cluster consists of multiple nodes. Each node has two processors on Biowulf. Each processor can have multiple cores. Each core has two CPUs. And then from the bottom up, programs executing as processes can have single threads of execution, or they can be multi-threaded. Finally, this slide illustrates a point we will come back to in subsequent videos. For optimal execution of a program, you always want to run a single thread on a single CPU. This is the end of our basic concepts and terminology video.